What I'd love to do is, let's start. Actually, this will go in program order. We will start with you, please, Josh.
Okay.
Tell us who you are, your film, and what you what your role was.
My name is Josh Swade. I directed Rick Was Here, and I mean, that's
okay.
Pretty much it.
That's pretty much it. So tell us how you came to the idea of it. Did you know Rick? Were you, no.
Yeah. So I had a friend who worked at Rolling Stone, and he came to me and said, hey, we want to do video on our website, but we haven't really wanted to do it yet because it's really expensive. Do you have any ideas as to what we could do? And I said, I think you guys should do documentary shorts because there's a ton of great stories out there about musicians, and people love short documentaries. So he said to me, great, go do one. And I said, well, what, you know, is there a budget? And he said, not really. So I thought, well, if I'm going to do a short on a musician and I don't have much of a budget, I probably need to stay in New York, which is where I'm based. And because it was New York, I figured, you know, being that New York's the birthplace of hip-hop, that hip-hop was a natural sort of touch point. And then I remembered this sort of folk story about Rick Rubin starting Def Jam Records in his dorm room. And so I did some research, and lo and behold, I was surprised to find that the dorm room was still there, untouched, and Rick had never been back. And not only had he never been back, but there wasn't a plaque there. There was never any sort of commemoration that this is where this iconic, you know, American record label was started. So it seemed like the perfect way to launch this initiative. And I reached out to Rick's, he has a publicist, and she's not really, you know, he's a very unusual guy. He doesn't really have a team of people behind him. And I said, hey, we got this idea. We want to bring Rick back to Weinstein Hall, and we're going to tell the story over the course of a short documentary. And she said, oh, that's a great idea, but it's never going to happen. And basically her thing was, Rick doesn't travel. He lives in Malibu. He doesn't travel for anyone. He makes artists come to him. And so I kept bugging her. And then out of the blue, a couple months later, she sent me a note and said, Rick is coming to New York to be on Saturday Night Live with Eminem. And I told him about your idea. And he said, you know what? It sounds fun. So we had to pull it off in 24 hours. We had to clear it with NYU, which was like next to impossible. There were two students living in that room. We had to like kick them out. And lo and behold, we pulled it off. And once we got that interview in the can, we were able to go and fill in the pieces.
Thank you so much.
That was very long. Sorry.
No, that's great. Leron, do you want to tell us who you are in your film?
Hi. My name's Liron Revach in Hebrew, and I'm from New York City originally, but I moved to Israel 16 years ago. And I co-wrote, co-produced, and directed No Free Lunch.
Can you tell us where the idea came from?
I'd rather not. No, kidding. Okay.
If you don't want to answer it, that's
no,
okay.
I do. It's it is kind of a personal story. I mean, I didn't go as far as the actress, the character, but when I moved to Israel 16 years ago, I needed a job. I came with $300 in my pocket, and a degree in geology was not going to help me a lot, but my English was going to help me, and I figured I'd work at an internet startup company and try to make some money. So I went for a job interview, and I kind of like embellished the truth. I knew I could do it, but I didn't have any experience. So I kind of made it sound like I knew what I was talking about. I needed them to see what they wanted to see so that I could get my foot in the door and start doing the work. And it worked. But the idea started from there, and when I was very young, I had a very interesting relationship with deception and lies, and I've very much changed since then, but I just thought it would be an interesting way to create closure for me in that department. Just
Andre, could you tell us? Please introduce yourself and actually tell everybody the two films that you have in the festival, please.
All right, I'm Andre Herman. I did Andrew with Great Fanfare and one other film was screened on Wednesday, I guess. Bavinia, I only want to dance. I just want to dance. Yeah.
It's your film, you should know the title.
Yeah, but it's a German title and it's translated, so I get confused with it. Yeah, so two children's portraits and I'm really happy to be here.
Well, and thank you. Your film is about aspiration. And I'd like to know how you chose Andrew. And did you, when you were shooting, did you follow Andrew for the entire shoot? Or did you have a couple kids that you were following?
No, we didn't. We just followed Andrew. I watched a lot of Tremé before, the Tremé TV show. So I knew about New Orleans and Mardi Gras, and I really wanted to do something about that. So I went there, and I think last New Year's Eve, and did some research. I had an assistant there that introduced me to some kids, and one of them was the little Tada, and the other one was Andrew. And I was really thinking of who should I pick for the film. But since the little one always wanted to destroy our camera, I chose the other one. And he wouldn't answer any question and stuff, so he was a brat. I really liked Andrew because he's like, his heart is in it, and he has he had a clear goal and strived for it and wanted to achieve it, and he was very open-minded and comfortable in front of the camera, and I didn't care that much if he's going to make it or not, but I liked his attempt, so this is why we chose him.
I was going to say, it's a risk for a filmmaker. Usually when you have some sort of a contest, you usually cover your bases by having a couple of subjects, so it turned out well for all of you.
Yeah, right. It would have been a downer a little bit, so I'm really happy with it.
So I'd like to open it up to everyone in the house for your questions, please. Yes, David. How does a filmmaker from Berlin make a connection with a 14-year-old boy in post-Katrina New Orleans, and what was that like?
For one, I don't feel that adult as well, so I'm kind of the same level. I think it's always that I feel that people like to tell their stories, and if you ask and try to listen, they kind of appreciate it. Not always, but quite often. So I just listened, I guess. Yeah, as I said, I mean, I watched Tremé a lot, so I got the idea to do a children's portrait. I've been to Chicago last year for a year, so I was already in the U.S., and then I went to New Orleans, and it was just a small step to go there and do the research then. So, and I really wanted to do something on Mardi Gras, as I said, because it's just great.
Another question? Up in the balcony, anybody have a question they'd like to ask? Down on the floor? Yes.
Can you repeat that? You know, we actually had an intern in the office who was an NYU student, so as soon as we got the call that Rick would do it, we went down to the dorm room to talk to the girls who lived in the room, and we kind of threw them some cash because we weren't so sure we were going to even clear it with NYU, because we just figured in 24 hours with all that bureaucracy, there's no way this will happen. But then we, you know, our cooler heads prevailed, and we had a very high-level person call the president of NYU. And that sort of opened the door for us. So that's how we got in. Yeah.
For each of you, actually, each of your films deals with with either a real person or a character who has aspirations and is really making a leap. And I'd like to know, what did your character teach you?
I mean, you know, the message I think from Rick Was Here is something we've all heard before, but it's always nice to hear it again. And it's just, you know, don't necessarily focus on the end result. Focus on doing something and putting your, you know, everything you have into it to make it as good as it can possibly be. And if that's an artistic endeavor, then really dig in on making the best art you can make, irregardless of the outcome. And that's all Rick cared about. He just cared about the art. And the rest of it took care of itself, really.
What did I learn from my character?
I know you wrote, you had a screenwriter, but when you lived with a character,
mm-hmm.
what did your character teach you?
That lying pays off. I don't really feel like I learned from her, honestly. It wasn't that kind of a character. She was, she portrays a part of my life that I've passed. It's not me anymore. And it's an extreme case. So I kind of feel like I took her under my wings and led her to the path that I would have liked her to have taken. But I myself wouldn't be doing that nowadays, you know. So.
Well, there just is such a timeliness about the subject and people looking for work. And so that even though there's moral questions, and actually there's a lot of morality comes up a lot in a lot of the shorts that we've seen, and the choices that people make. But it was, I guess, can you relate it to a bigger story?
Yeah, absolutely. I think in that respect, I mean, the character is encouraged to use her skills to go beyond the lack of social status that she has. She wasn't able to go to the army because she had to take care of her mother. She didn't have the money. She wasn't able to go to school, and she's an intelligent young woman, and she used everything that she could to be able to survive and break through the barriers that were in her life. So I guess in that respect.
Thank you.
What did I learn? I mean,
what did you learn from Andrew?
Yeah, right. I mean, I kind of, obviously, I liked his clearness and that he has his goal and strive for it. I respect that a lot. I guess I wasn't that kind of guy, unfortunately. But impressed by was that he was able to kind of lead that 60-70 kids band I always feel I have to be kind to people I want to get a connection and be nice and whatever, but you can just put them on the ground, so and they listen and it kind of worked, and that impressed me a lot. So but honestly, I learned more from Tara, the six-year-old, because he was such a stubborn brat and everybody loved him. So I thought maybe you don't have to be that nice all the time. You can just be a brat.
And actually, a two-part follow-up to that. Have you been in touch with Andrew since, and has the film screened for Andrew and his school?
We didn't screen it in New Orleans. He watched it, obviously, so I sent him a link immediately. And I hope we are able to screen it at the New Orleans Film Festival. Let's see, I mean, if they pick it. That would be nice. I would love to show it to the whole marching band and the teachers. What was that? He's doing nice. He's that was last year, so I think it was his second Mardi Gras, being the drum major, and he's still in it. Yeah. I think a couple of months ago I talked to him. He wanted to invite me for another shoot because there was some event he was leading, so we should come, but unfortunately we didn't.
Josh, for you, with your film, you depend on a lot of, you have the dorm room, which is fantastic. Nobody knew that the two girls who lived there, were they sort of surprised that this guy had
Yeah, they didn't. They not only, well, it's a freshman dorm. Weinstein's now an NYU freshman dorm. The two girls living there had never heard of Rick Rubin, didn't know anything really about Def Jam Records, and or, you know, for that matter, LL Cool J, the Beastie Boys. I mean, it just goes to show how old I am, certainly. I don't know. I was pretty surprised by that. But then once they got online and did some research, they were like, oh, this is so cool. You know, they were very psyched about it. But
and you make some interesting choices. You have the animation. You have the footage. Talk about the creative choices that you made to tell the story.
You know, we did all the digging we could to find, you know, archival footage and still photos and that sort of thing. But at the end of the day, we just didn't have enough of the dorm room. And this story is about what happened in one little dorm room. So that kind of forced our hand to animate. And we thought, okay, well, if we got to animate, let's have fun with it. And go this somewhat cartoon route. It was almost like a pencil on page thing. And, you know, as soon as we tried a few different looks, but once we saw that, it was like, oh, that's the right look for the period. And then you can do whatever you want. You can animate any scene you want and tell any story you want. It just gives you all kinds of creative freedom. Yeah.
Liron, with your film, can you talk about the casting and also your choice of music?
Okay. I was looking all around for a Sarai. It was important for me that she wouldn't be beautiful, so that wouldn't be one of the attributes that would help her get the job. And I have a lot of friends in the industry, and I asked them to throw me names because I myself am not 100% familiar. I don't watch Israeli television. And a dear friend of mine who's a script supervisor SMS'd me a name. And so I went into YouTube and I watched a show that she had done. And she got the job. She just needed to want it. So I got her email from my friend and I sent it to her. And all of a sudden I get a phone call. And she says, listen, I don't know who you are. I get about 7 offers a day. But I loved your script. I want to do it. And I was like, great. She's like, okay, are you free tomorrow? She started telling me, are you free tomorrow? Can I come over? And she came over and she just sat right next to me. She spoke to me like this. And I loved her. I loved everything about her. And there was just something so interesting about her energy and her vibe. And I got lucky with her because about a month after my film came out, she became a huge star with another film that came out called Zero Motivation in Israel. And it just it helped me with my film and other places, including Israel. So I got lucky with that.
Before you answer the question on music, was there anything when you worked with her, was there anything that she wanted to change about the script? Or were there things that happened when you were shooting that she brought to the script that you didn't have?
No. She liked the script the way it was. My only problem was that I didn't have a lot of rehearsal time with them. And when I did a cold reading with them, with both Alon Leshem and Nelly Tagar, I couldn't understand a word she was saying. She speaks really fast, and she just, blah, 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 you know, threw it out. And at the end of the reading, I said, she said, don't worry about it. Next time you'll understand me. She knew exactly what I was talking about. And then on set, she was perfect. So.
And for the music, because the music, there's two places in the film that you use the music, and it definitely, you translate the lyrics a lot of times, they don't. Could you tell us about your choices there?
Yes, absolutely. I listen to English music. I live in Israel and I speak Hebrew, but I don't read Hebrew and I don't write Hebrew and I don't know Israeli music that well. So I just kind of started listening to music on YouTube, and I couldn't find anything until I got a Facebook invite from a friend who said that his sister was playing at a bar, and I went into the website and I listened to her to this song, and I was just flabbergasted because it was like I had asked her to write this song for my movie. And regarding the second song, my editor had put like a go happy ending song at the end, and I knew that was wrong, and I looked for something that just kind of didn't sit right, you know, like kind of made you think, because at the end of the movie, it depends on the person's relationship with deception. They if they hate deception and they don't believe in it, then they don't want her to get the job and they're not happy about it. And if they agree with the structure and the use of her tactics, they're much more forgiving. And I think that the music was really good about that. And it was somebody very, very familiar in Israel. And I asked her for permission and she gave it to me. So I'm very happy about that. My only regret is that I did translate it. I think that now that I watch it, and I'm watching it from this perspective and on, it's very difficult to translate poetry, and I don't think it relays well, and I think that I'd rather have the audience focus on what's on the screen. And I'm curious to know if Americans agree with that, just because so far in Israel, it's not necessary to translate. It just resonates as poetry, so...
I don't know, it worked for me. I think it's a really sort of an interesting punctual, because a lot of times we see music in films that's not translated. For instance, the other night in Overtime, the Jordanian film, that music, they used a couple of songs, and I really, because the music was imparting something about the tone, I, for one, really wanted to know what the lyrics were. I mean, if they were pop lyrics and silly, I would have been disappointed, I guess. I'd like to open it again to you to ask questions, please. These filmmakers would love to hear what you have to say. Yes. How long were you filming, Andrew?
I think it was, as I said, I was there 5 days for research, meeting all the kids, and then I came back in last February for 9 days, I guess, during the process of the picking of the drum major and his tasks, and then for 3 more days during Mardi Gras. So I did the whole march for 1.5 hours. That was nice.
I thought there was another question. Yes, please. The question is that there's a redemptive moment or shedding a redemptive light on the character when it cuts to the restaurant where the server's picking up the large tip. Could you say why you included that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I felt that since this is a short, there isn't enough exposition for you to understand that she's not a bad person and that she just doesn't use people left and right. And that she is, there's a certain sense of like female empowerment in this film, I think, and she brought her down and pretty much stepped on her, you know, and she needed to bring her back up, and she did it, I think, in a very subtle way, and it helped her feel better about herself. And I think that in films where there's an anti-heroine, I mean, I'm not saying that she's 100% anti-heroine, but there's always something likable about her, and I think that helped in that department.
Any other questions? Yes, please. How did you go from a degree in geology to making films?
Well, I started out acting in high school in New York, LaGuardia High School of Performing Arts, and I decided that I didn't want to be a waitress for the rest of my life. So I decided to go to college and do, at the age of 17, you don't really know what you want to do for the rest of your life. So, you know, they drink beer in the department, and I got good grades in geology, and I love hiking, and I love knowing what I'm looking at. So I studied geology, and I knew that it didn't mean that I had to do it for the rest of my life. But when I got to Israel and I started working in marketing, I was a product manager, and you produce products and projects, and it was so easy to just move from producing in an internet company to actually producing a film event. And it was just very natural for me to move into that. And eventually it got me to directing, so.
Josh, how did you get into directing?
Well, I work in television primarily. I do some live.
What do you do?
What do I do? I am a producer on two award shows, the ESPYs and something called NFL Honors. It's the NFL's award show. So just working in that field, you know, and wanting to tell stories, I've started to do more documentary work over the years. I directed a 30 for 30, an ESPN film. And from there, you know, I've been branching out. I mean, I love basically sports and music. So I try and do stuff in those two fields.
And Andre, for you, you've been making documentary for a while. So could you talk about how, like, when you started documentary and where you are now, how do you think you've evolved as a filmmaker?
So I do this since 2000, I guess. Hell, that's 15 years. I think I started out not thinking too much about like story arc, and I wasn't that focused on. I like to do like people's portraits, obviously, and try to give them a voice and try to tell their subjective view. And I started understanding that it's not necessary to film like 24/7 the whole surrounding, but you can just focus and follow. So and then I think I'm more kind of effective now because I kind of think in like what I need for the story, and I think that kind of I got better in that, I hope.
Thank you so much for bringing your films and being here. And I hope that you and the audience will take a moment to thank them and talk to them downstairs.
Thank you. Thank you.